Vampires may not seem like they're ready to shake up the meta, but any deck that can take advantage of the deep pool of zombie support that's out there is worth keeping an eye on. Hi, I'm Golden Nova, and in this video, I'm going to go over all the vampire cards coming out in Dark Saviors, with more videos going over old vampires, cards that synergize with the archetype, and a few of the deck's optimal combos. First off, we have Vampire Familiar and Vampire Brood, the latest addition to Yu-Gi-Oh's long line of undead good doggies. Both monsters can be special summoned from the grave by sending a vampire card from your hand or field to the graveyard, though they get banished if they leave the field after that, and if they're special summoned by any means, they can search you a card. Familiar gets you a vampire monster, except for another familiar, while Brood gets you a vampire spell or trap card. Both are good search effects, but since they both rely on you to have other cards to spend on them to do anything, I mean, look at that stat line, I wouldn't play any more than two of each. Next up are the level 5 and 6 vampires, but as a preface, all of them share an effect in addition to their unique ones. If any of them destroy a monster or monsters by battle, you can special summon them at the end of the battle phase to your side of the field. It's pretty neat since it doesn't have any drawbacks, but since you have to get past arguably the most impactful phase of your turn to trigger this effect, I'm not going to give it much weight when going over them, though I do acknowledge the insane snowballing that this can lead into. Vampire Fraulein's initial stats look god-awful, but don't be deceived, she'll lay the smackdown. You can special summon her from your hand whenever any monster attacks, so you never have to worry about fielding her, and anytime any zombie battles, you can pay life points in multiples of 100, up to a 3,000 point cap, and that zombie gains attack and defense equal to that amount for that battle only. This makes for an excellent monster to add off of Familiar, giving you a battle trick that can let any of your zombies body just about anyone. Vampire Grimson is a little more on the reactive side. It lets you pay 1,000 life points to prevent the destruction of any of your monsters, though it does pay 1,000 individually as opposed to protecting against a board wipe with a single 1,000. So Regeki and Darkhold is going to cost you 3,000 if you have 3 monsters on the board that you want to keep, but it is better than not having the option at all. Another thing to note is that it will protect any of your monsters. It's not limited to vampires or zombies or anything, so if you summon anything that's powerful and effective but off-theme, Grimson still gives you some insurance. I wouldn't put many into my deck personally, but putting Grimson next to a strong negation board smells like auto-wins to me. Vampire Scargelet? Scargelet? Vampire Scarlight Red Dragon Archfiend is definitely one of my favorite new vampires. When he's normal or special summoned, you can pay 1,000 life points to summon any other vampire from your graveyard, though it can't attack that turn. This is by far the best way to trigger your searchers. You can summon Familiar or Brood to fix your hand, or grab another level 6 vampire to go into the deck's boss monster, which is super impactful. Unfortunately, since it only summons from the graveyard, it's still a little setup reliant, but once you get into the mid-game, this becomes an amazing card to summon off of Mizuki. Vampire Red Baron is kind of a... Wait, what is... Why has this guy got Monarch stats? What the... Okay, Vampire Monarch has kind of a creature swap thing going on. It lets you pay 1,000 to trade any one of your other vampires you control for any of your opponent's monsters. It seems kind of costly, but considering Familiar and Brood are pretty easy to summon, they make great swap fodder. Even if the monster you take has no redeeming qualities for your deck, you gave them a wimpy little nobody that you can easily run over. And hey, it works perfectly well with our next card, El Vampire, Vampire Sheridan. Vampires. Anyway, this card is super nutty. It takes 2 or more level 6 monsters, but any monster that you have that's owned by your opponent that has a level counts as level 6 for its summon. This gives every monster stealing effect that much more utility and making the effects less dependent on what your opponent has to offer. You can turn anything short of Lynx and other Xyz monsters into fodder for this dashing duke. But what does he do? Well, I'm glad you asked, person who's never seen this video before. Once per turn, Sheridan can detach a material to target and send one card your opponent controls to the grave. Also, once per turn, if a monster or monsters are sent from your opponent's field to the graveyard via battle or card effect, you can detach a material to bring it or all of them to your side of the field in defense position. So not only does Sheridan have the ability to trigger the effect himself, making him self-sufficient, he also combos quite nicely with other removal cards like, Regeki, causing game-winning swings in card economy. It's spot removal, it summons fodder to make more Sheridans, what's not to like? And a list of new vampire cards wouldn't be complete without bringing up Vampire Sucker. God, I hope they change that name in translation. Technically, it comes out in Flames of Destruction, not Dark Saviors, but hey, it's a vampire video, and it's too good not to mention. Being a link monster that requires only two zombie monsters, Sucker lets you tribute any of your opponent's zombies for any of your own tribute summons. Now, that sounds terrible in anything save for a mirror match, but let's not forget what else she can do, namely, summon an opponent's monster from the grave to their side of the field, treating it as a zombie. Now, I know what you're thinking. This sounds like possibly the worst effect ever, and I don't blame you. But much in the same vein as our meta-warping Electromite, Sucker gives you a draw once per turn whenever a zombie is special summoned from any graveyard. So, yeah, give your opponent a monster, tribute it for one of your new high-level vampires, and you walk away with a new card draw. Easy. But if you've already used your normal summon, then how are you going to vampire kaiju your opponent? Well, now that we've moved on to spell cards, I can introduce you to Vampire Territory. It's a continuous spell that lets you pay 500 life points to normal summon or set a vampire in addition to your regular normal summon. See? So problems just solve themselves. On top of that, Territory gives you life points whenever you deal damage to your opponent equal to the amount of damage dealt, which makes me think that Fraulein and Territory put together is going to make for a mean win condition. Then there's Vampire Desire, a normal spell that lets you do one of two things. You can either send a vampire from your deck to the grave and have any other monster you control become that vampire's level to the end of the turn, or you can send a monster you control to the grave to summon a vampire from your grave. The first effect is pretty underwhelming, though it is nice to have in certain edge scenarios. Seriously, why are only two of these vampires level 6? The second effect seems better, but it's still going to be a minus 1, so whatever you summon is going to have to make up for it, which, to be fair, can be done with Familiar, Brood, or Vampire Scarlet, Red Dragon, Archfiend. And if you're using one of your opponent's monsters that you got for free off some other effect, then hey, go nuts. On to trap cards. Vampire Awake is a normal trap that summons any vampire from your deck, but it's destroyed during the end phase, and seriously, this card could have been so good if they had just printed it as a spell. I mean, it still does a lot of good stuff, like triggering your searchers, getting beefy bodies onto the board straight from the deck, but having to wait a turn really keeps you from going off. Despite it just missing being a good engine card, it's still worth playing a few copies. I mean, Red Baron can't be destroyed if it's Xyz material. Lastly, Vampire Domination, a countertrap for any situation. If you control a vampire monster, you can negate any spell card, trap card, or monster effect, destroy that card, and if it was a monster, you gain life points equal to that monster's attack. You're not really going to be quenching your thirst off negating something like a ghost ogre, but the life points are just a nice side bonus. Being able to have an Infernity Barrier on hand is great for basically any deck. And if you happen to destroy something that has a lot of attack points, well, that's just extra life points to fuel your other effects that are eating those up. I'm looking at you, Fraulein! God, I can't stay mad at you. Anyway, what do you guys make of these Masters of the Night? Personally, I think the deck has some solid utility and removal options, but I'd like to see a good starter card or a consistent engine that brings it all together. Will we be able to find some in the existing vampire archetype, or will we have to rob some other graves to find it? Subscribe to stay up to date with my analysis videos, and I'll see you next time. Buh-bye.